Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor D. Velmurugan, University Grants Commission Basic Scientific Research Faculty from Center of Advanced Study in Crystallography and Biophysics, University of Madras, Chennai. Today we are going to talk on module dealing with crystals, unit cell, lattices, point groups and space groups. All these modules come under the paper Biocrystallography. So students, let us see what we are going to learn in this module as the objectives. So we are going to learn what is a crystal, how to define a unit cell, what do you mean by a lattice and what are Breves lattices, what do you mean by symmetry and what do you mean by lattice directions and planes, what are meant by Miller indices and finally what do you mean by point groups and space groups. Now let us give a brief introduction to this topic. The difference between a solid and a crystal is that in crystals there is a three-dimensional periodicity or regular arrangement. So what do you mean by periodicity? Suppose you keep a set of objects with a uniform separation between them along one direction, these objects are supposed to have a one-dimensional periodicity. You can keep a set of same objects in one more direction, there the separation need not be the same. Now the one and two direction together they are called two-dimensional periodicity. You can consider one more direction perpendicular to this and you can have similar arrangement. Put together, all the three directions are called three-dimensional periodicity. Based on concepts like a unit cell, lattices, point groups and space groups, which we are going to see later, the basics of crystallography was formulated by many scientists. In fact, well before the discovery of X-rays and the discovery of diffraction phenomena by crystal and also the condition for the diffraction maximum, many scientists, particularly the mineralogists and the geologists, started working on the crystals. Most of the above concepts are for easier understanding of the diffraction pattern and also for interpreting it. Crystals. Crystals are substances where there is a three-dimensional periodicity of molecules. So let us first understand what do you mean by periodicity. Let us consider a set of same objects and you just keep them at a finite distance along one direction so that the successive distance between the objects will be the same. Then this is known as one-dimensional periodicity. Now you can take a direction perpendicular to that. Again you can keep other set of objects where the distance of separation between successive objects will not be the same like previous case, but it will be different, but along this direction it will be same. So now together it is known as two-dimensional periodicity. Now if we take another perpendicular direction and keep objects with a successive distance of separation by some other distance, which is not need not be same between the things we observed for the one and second direction, now we together call it as a three-dimensional periodicity. Now if you look at crystals, for example, sodium chloride, copper sulfate and zinc sulfide, so these are all solids. Then does it mean that all crystals can be solids, or can you call all solids are crystals? No. It is only the three-dimensional periodicity that distinguishes a solid from a crystal. Only crystal possess the three-dimensional periodicity of molecules. A crystal selected for single crystal X-ray diffraction purpose should be a single crystal of about 0.2 millimeter dimension in length, breadth and thickness. This is sufficient for single crystal X-ray diffraction work to unravel the molecular structures present in the crystal. These crystals should not have any cracks and there should not be any cluster formation. Once diffraction quality crystals are obtained, the rest of the process in getting the molecular structure is more or less automatic during present times. Unit cell. Unit cell is the smallest repeating unit in a crystal in three dimensions, and molecules composed of various atomic species lie in the unit cell. A simple example for the unit cell is nothing but a matchbox. You can consider a small number of matchsticks in the matchbox as a molecule, and the matchbox itself can be considered as an unit cell. Now you can repeat the matchbox by keeping other matchboxes next to each other. So then, back side also you can keep a row of matchbox, front side also you can keep a row of matchbox, and above these you can keep a matchbox. So now this is known as three-dimensional arrangement of these matchboxes. So similarly, in a crystal, the matchbox is replaced by a unit cell, the match sticks are replaced by molecules. So this is an easier visualization of unit cell in crystals. Like a matchbox having three axes, length, breadth, and width, the unit cell is also characterized by six parameters, and three are the cell edges conventionally called A, B, C along X, Y, and Z directions respectively, and three are angles called alpha, beta, and gamma. Alpha is the angle opposite to A axis, beta is the angle opposite to B axis, and gamma is the angle opposite to C axis. So these things will be clearly known to you once you see the figures which will be shown to you later. Now, based on the distribution among the six unit cell parameters, the crystal systems can be classified into seven types. Whether your molecule crystallizes as a small molecule or a protein molecule, now the total number of crystal systems is always seven, irrespective of the molecule is containing small number of atoms or thousands of atoms like proteins or enzymes and so on. Another important property one has to know here is why it is called unit. Even though you say A is the repeat along X direction, B is the repeat along Y direction, and C is the repeat along Z direction, now I am going to consider each A, B, C as one unit with an understanding that one unit along X direction means A, one unit along Y direction means B, one unit along Z direction is C. So once you have this imagination, then since molecules have to lie in the unit cell, the coordinates of this molecule or atoms in the molecule have to be lesser than one conventionally, because the maximum separation in the unit cell along the three axis is only one unit. Sometimes if you look into the coordinates of the molecule, you see that some atom has a coordinate, it's called a fractional coordinate, because all these units are positions are less than one. That is why it's known as fractional coordinates of atoms. Sometimes you see along X or Y or Z direction, the value is slightly greater than one. This means that that atom along that direction has peeped into the next unit cell. To compensate that, from the lower unit cell or from the side unit cells, same atom will be peeping into the original unit cell. So what I want to say here is, suppose a unit cell contains four molecules, do not expect all the four full molecules in the unit cell. One molecule may be full, other may be half. If half is leaving, other half will be entering and so on. But total number of molecules in the unit cell will be 2, 4, like that. Let me first introduce you to the lattices. The concept of the lattice is useful as a simple way of describing the periodicity of a crystal structure. As I told you in the beginning, the crystal structure is built up by repetition of a small repeating unit called the unit cell, and this can be completely and very simply described by replacing each repeat unit by a lattice point placed at an exactly equivalent point in each and every repeat unit. Now you get a two-dimensional picture known as a lattice. All these lattice points have the same environment in the same orientation and are indistinguishable from one another. Now coming to the unit cells, these are of two types, the simple or primitive cell denoted by a symbol capital P or capital R, and non-primitive cells like body centered denoted by capital I, face centered denoted by capital F, base centered denoted by capital C. The primitive cells have only one lattice point per cell, while the non-primitive have more than one. We will see these in detail later. Let us come to the Breville lattice. Breville, the French crystallographer, in 1848 worked on the problem of lattice types and demonstrated that there are 14 possible point lattices only. Whether your molecule comes from protein, macromolecule, or a small molecule like a ligand, when they crystallize, they have to crystallize one among these 14 possible lattices only. These are termed as brevi lattice or point lattice. If a point is placed at the center of each cell of a cubic point lattice, the new array of points also forms a point lattice. Similarly, another point lattice can be used as a cubic unit cell having lattice point at each corner and in the center of each face.
14 brevi lattices. Here, a table is shown along with a picture showing the different systems belonging to the 14 brevi lattices. As I told you in the beginning, the unit cell has 6 cell parameters. 3 are the edges, are the axial lengths, and 3 are the angles. If you consider the 3 cell edges A, B, C to be equal, and all the 3 angles alpha, beta, gamma equal to 90 degree, then this is known as a cubic system. Then if 2 of the cell dimension A equals B, which is not equal to C, and 3 angles are 90 degree, this is known as tetragonal system. If all the 3 cell edges are unequal, but all the 3 angles are 90 degrees, then it is known as orthorhombic system. If we consider the rhombohedral systems, here all the 3 axes are equal and are equally inclined, but alpha is equal to beta, equal to gamma, but not equal to 90 degree. Then we have the hexagonal system, 2 equal coplanar axes at 120 degree, third axis is at right angles. So A equals B, not equal to C, alpha equals beta equals to 90 degree, but gamma equals 120 degree. Now you come to the monoclinic system, where we talk about 3 unequal axes, one pair not at right angles, which means that A is not equal to B, A, B is not equal to C, but alpha equals gamma equals 90 degree, which is not equal to beta. Then we have the triclinic system, where we talk about 3 unequal axes, unequal incline, and none at right angles, which means that A is not equal to B, not equal to C, alpha is not equal to beta, not equal to gamma, not equal to 90 degree or 120 degree. So these are the classification regarding the 7 crystal systems. Now, suppose you have a small molecule crystallizing into the system, one system, and we have a macromolecule crystallizing into one system. Whatever may be the molecule size, whether it is small or macromolecule, the crystal systems are always totally to only 7. Now, we have to consider the lattice types. If you look at the figure, we have 8 corners. At each of the 8 corners, we have a lattice point. If this is the case, then you call it as a simple or primitive lattice, denoting it by a symbol capital P. So now if you look into the monoclinic system, we have the primitive lattice denoted by P and also something marked as C. So this is C is nothing but a base-centered system. Look at the base face and also a face opposite to the base face, that is the top and bottom. At the center of these faces, you find a lattice point. These lattice points are in addition to the lattice point at 8 corners of the unit cell, and this is known as C-type lattice or base-type lattice. If we just look into the second row, we are having the figures for the orthorhombic system. Already you know what is primitive and you know what is a C-center. But the second figure in this row is marked as I. This is known as body-centered system. If you look here carefully, at the center of the unit cell, there will be a lattice point. So, and this is known as body center. Now, a cube has 6 faces. In base center, we have seen 2 opposite faces. At the center, we have lattice points. Here, 6 faces are there. One is facing you and again behind, then top and bottom, then other set is sideways. So, in all these 6 faces, at the center, there will be a lattice point. If so, it is known as face-centered lattice. So now we have 4 types of lattices: primitive or simple P-type, then body-centered, which is known as I-type, then base-centered, which is known as C-type, and face-centered, which is known as F-type. When you talk about base-centered C-type, now that face will be containing A and B axis. So this is a conventional. So now, when you talk about the 7 crystal systems, These four types of lattices are distributed among the seven crystal systems, totaling to 14 different types of lattices. This is known as 14 Brevi lattices belonging to the seven crystal systems. As I've been telling from the beginning, whether your crystal comes from a small molecule or macromolecule, there are always 14 Brevi lattices only. If you look at those figures which I have seen previously, it appears as if the primitive unit cell contains 8 lattice points. Practically, it is not true, because if you just consider primitive unit cell, in the crystal, we talk about another unit cell adjacent to this. So, 2 unit cells are there, 1 point will be common. Then, you can consider at the back side similar 2 unit cells. So, totally, each lattice point is common to 4 unit cells. Now, imagine above these 4 unit cells, again 4 unit cells are placed. So, in this way, if you just imagine, one lattice point is shared by 8 unit cells. In other words, the contribution of each lattice point to a particular unit cell is only 1/8. So, since there are 8 such lattice points, the total number of lattice points in a primitive cell is 8 times 1 by 8, which is equal to 1. So, like that, if you talk about Ni as the number of interior points, which will happen in body-centered lattice, that is 1. If you look at the your face-centered, no, each face will be shared by another unit cell kept on top of it. So, which means that the effective lattice point for the face-centered with respect to that unit cell is only half. So, now we talk about lattice points in the interior of a cell belonging to that cell, while one in a cell face is shared by 2 cells and one at the corner is shared by 8 unit cells. The number of lattice points per cell is therefore given by n equals ni plus half times nf plus 1/8 times nc, where ni is the number of interior points, nf is the number of points on faces, and nc is the number of points on corners. Thus, any cell containing lattice points on the corners only is therefore primitive, while the one containing additional points in the interior or on faces is non-primitive. The symbols F and I refer to face-centered and body-centered cells respectively, while the capital letters A, B, C refer to base-centered cells centered on one pair of opposite faces of A, B, or C. Conventionally, A face is the face defined by the B and C axis, etc. Already we have seen that in the unit cell, the dimension is always 1 unit along A axis, 1 unit along B axis, 1 unit along C axis. Now, imagining this A face made up of A and A face made up of B and C axis, the center of the A face, the unit cell, will be practically positioned at 0, half, half, and center of B face will be having the sides C and A as axis, and that will be half, 0, half, and center of C face will be containing A and B axis, and its position is half, half, 0. So now we are going to see what it is meant by symmetry. You can look at the figures also. If some operations like translation, rotation about an axis, reflection, rotation followed by the translation, etc., can be performed by a structure which will bring it into coincidence with itself, then these are termed symmetry operations. As a simple example, we can consider a cube. If we look at the cube, this has several planes of symmetry, which is described in the figure enclosed. So, the face of each cube is a square. Let us say I will show you one face. I ask you to close your eyes. I rotate the cube by 90 degrees. I ask you to open your eyes. I am asking you, did you see anything differently? You say no, because for you, the same face appears to be being looked at. But I have done a rotation of 90 degrees. So, if a rotation of 360 degrees divided by n brings the body or structure into self-coincidence, now you say the body has an n-fold rotational symmetry. Now, if it has a 4-fold rotational symmetry, for example, then the angle of rotation needed to bring the body into self-coherence is nothing but 360 degree divided by 4, which is equal to 90 degree. So if it is 3, 4, then 360 degree divided by 3, which is equal to 120 degree. Then if it is 2, 4 rotation, it is 360 degree divided by 2, which is equal to 180 degree. In any point lattice, a unit cell may be chosen in an infinite number of ways and may contain one or more lattice points per cell. So as we have seen already, even though there are 8 lattice points in the primitive cell, the contribution of each of these points to that unit cell is only 1/8. Therefore, effectively, in the primitive unit cell, the total number of lattice points is nothing but 8 times 1 by 8, which is equal to 1. If you look at the body center, so this 1 is added with the lattice point at the center, so 1 plus 1 equal to 2. For the face center, as I told you, every lattice point contributes to half only to the unit cell because it is shared by 2 unit cells, each face. So now we talk about face centered, 1 point coming from the contribution from primitive plus 6 faces times half. Therefore, 1 plus half into 6, which is equal to 1 plus 3, equal to 4. For in effect, 4 lattice points. If it is base centered, then it is 1 plus half times 2, 1 plus 1, 2. So we have a figure here. It shows a unit cell. If we just look inside the unit cell, there are some dashed lines that also forms a unit cell. What do you mean by this? So this figure explains the position of any lattice point in a cell in terms of its coordinates. If you look at the bottom face, this is containing A and B axis. So the center is D. So this D is nothing but half, half, 0. This is the point of location of D. If you look at the opposite face above in the unit cell, that is E. So now D and E are said to be equivalent point because one is up face, other is down face. Again, if you look into the side faces, B is the center of the face containing B and C axis. Therefore, its position will be 0, half, half. If you look at a face opposite to this, there is a lattice point at the center. Again, these are equivalent. Same thing, if you look at the front side facing you, so this contains axes A and C. Center is C. So the location of C is nothing but half, 0, half. Opposite to that, at the back side of the unit cell, we have the center.
If point A is taken as the origin having coordinate 0, 0, 0, then lattice points B, C and D will have coordinates 0, half, half, comma, half, 0, half, comma, half, half, 0, respectively. This can easily be seen from the figure we have seen earlier. So like that, points E and D are equivalent and have the coordinates as half, half, 1, because one of these points is shifted from the base to the top and the translation is along C, that is 1 unit. The coordinates of equivalent points in different unit cells can always be made identical by the addition or subtraction of a set of integral coordinates. This is true in case of angles also. In angles, you can always add 360 one cycle or subtract 360. Now, in the unit cells, subtraction of 0, 0, 1 from the coordinates half, half, 1 of point E just gives you half, half, 0, the coordinates of D, and this is the reason that points D and E are equivalent points. So, here you have to consider one more point. There is something known as centering translations. So, the centering translation always contains the origin point 0, 0, 0. If it is body centered, the centering translation points will be 0, 0, 0 and half, half, half. If it is a face centered, then the center translation will be 0, 0, 0, the origin, comma, 0, half, half, then half, 0, half, then half, half, 0. Each of these three points denote the three sets of faces. Now we've talked about base centered, it is 0, 0, 0, half, half, 0. We have seen that
An n-fold rotation axis of symmetry is defined as a line, a rotation above which produce congruent positions, namely positions indistinguishable for the initial position after rotation through 2 pi over n degrees. 1-fold, 2-fold, 3-fold, 4-fold and 6-fold rotation axis are denoted by the symbols 1, 2, 3, 4 and 6. Now, what do you mean by a screw axis? It is a rotation followed by a translation. A screw axis 2-1 means that there is a 2-fold rotation about the conventional B axis followed by a translation of half along the B axis. By 2-fold rotation, I mean about the B axis, the angle of rotation is 360 degree divided by 2, which is equal to 180 degree. So, for example, there is a group, point group known as 4-1, 3-1. What do you mean by 4-1? We have a 4-fold rotational symmetry. In other words, the rotation angle is 90 degree, followed by a translation of 1 by 4 along the B axis. B axis is always conventional axis about which rotations are made. If it is 3-1 screw, then it means we have a 3-fold rotation followed by a translation 1 by 3 along the B axis. Now we talk about mirror refraction. This is also another symmetry element. Inversion axis of symmetry is a distinct type of symmetry axis that combines rotation about a line through 2 pi over n with inversion through a point. These axes are also called inverse n-fold axis, where n may be 1, 2, 3, 4 and 6. During inversion through the origin of coordinates, every point with coordinate x, y, z becomes a point with coordinates minus x, minus y and minus z. If in a structure, every atom with coordinates x, y, z is duplicated by an atom of the same element with coordinates minus x, minus y, minus z, then the structure is said to possess center of symmetry at the origin. This is symbolically represented as one bar. In space group diagrams, the position of center of symmetry is denoted by a small open circle. If you look into the International Union of Crystallography Table 1, all the space group diagrams are given for the 230 space groups. The symmetry operator as a mirror plane or plane of symmetry is assigned the symbol little m, and the operation of the mirror plane amounts to rotation through 2 pi over 2 or 180 degree followed by the inversion through the center. During inversion through the origin of coordinates, every point with coordinates x, y, z becomes a point with coordinates minus x, minus y, minus z. Operation of the inverse triad, which you call as 3 bar, is equivalent to the operation of a triad 3 combined with a center of symmetry, that is 3 bar equals 3 plus 1 bar. The operation of the inverse hexad is equivalent to that of a triad combined with a perpendicular mirror plane, that is 6 bar equals 3 plus m. What do you mean by a glide plane? A glide plane is a translational symmetry element representing simultaneous reflection as in a mirror plane and a translation through half a lattice repeat in a direction parallel to the plane. So now we are going to see about lattice directions and planes. A figure is marked here for clear understanding. Let a point has coordinates little u, little v, little w in the lattice. The direction of any line in a lattice may be described by first drawing a line through the origin parallel to the given line and then giving the coordinate of the point on the line through the origin. If you write the u, v, w within square bracket, then these are the indices of the direction of the line. They are also the indices of any line parallel to the given line. U, v, w are always converted to a set of smallest integers by multiplication or division throughout. Now, just look at the figure. If you look the bottom face, along with A, there's an arrow marking 100. This is the lattice direction because this 100 is given within a square bracket. Why it is 100? It is an axis, a axis. So no B, no C. Therefore, B and C will be 0. It is simply 100. But if you look at the upper face, there is 1 bar 0 0. Why it is 1 bar? If you look at the bottom face, the arrow mark goes from left to right. If you look at the upper face, it goes from right to left. So that is why the 1 bar. So now you can see along the B axis, there is a bracketed term 0, 1, 0. Because it's a line passing through B axis. Okay, it's B. Therefore, A and C are absent. So it's called as 0, 1, 0. So like that, you can see an arrow along C axis marked within square bracket as 0, 0, 1. Because it is a line C. So A and B are 0. It is 0, 0, 1. Now, usually, suppose you have an example, you have a lattice direction, half, one, half. So if this is the case, it contains fractions, half, half, no? So to make, for convenience, it is converted into an integer by multiplying throughout by 2, which will make it as 1, 2, 1. We again multiply by 2, you can call it as 2, 4, 2. But all these represent the same direction, but conventionally, we prefer 1, 2, 1 written within the bracket. The figure represents the various indices of directions. For example, you can go through individually, the answers are also given. It's quite clear. Miller indices. These are the fractional intercepts which the plane makes with the crystallographic axis converted to their nearest integers. So let us see the figure. The figure shows the three cell edges A, B, C. There's a plane shaded and marked as HKL within the ordinary bracket. So now, if you look into the unit cell, the A axis value is 4 angstrom, the B axis value is 8 angstrom, C axis value is again 3 angstrom. Now, the A axis is split into 4 grid points, each is 1 angstrom, and the C axis is split into 3 grid units, again each is 1 angstrom, and the B axis is split into 8 grid units, each is 1 angstrom. Okay. Now, we have a plane, shaded plane, for which you have to index. Because Miller indices, as you know, it is used to designate any given plane. Just like every one of us has our own name, each black plane is given a name known as Miller indices. So, these indices can be positive or negative, including 0. To identify what is the Miller indices for this plane, let us consider what is the intercept it makes along the A, B and C axis. Along A axis, it has cut at 1 angstrom. Along B axis, it has cut at 4 angstrom. Along C axis, it has cut at 3 angstrom. So now I want to calculate the fractional intercepts. By fractional intercepts, I mean intercepts divided by the respective axis length. Therefore, fractional intercept will be 1 by 4, then 4 by 8 and 3 by 3, giving you 1/4, half and 1. Now, the above fractions are going to be converted into the nearest integer. So, these are Miller indices. Therefore, throughout you multiply by 4 to get you 1, 2, 4. Now, the Miller indices for this plane is 1, 2, 4.
Now, let us study what do you mean by crystallographic point groups. A combination of symmetric operators like rotation element, translation, reflection, etc. can operate on a lattice. The operators are the symmetric elements of a finite body or a structure must pass through a point which is taken as the center of the body. Such a combination or a group of symmetric elements is known as point group. A point group operating on a crystalline solid must be such that every symmetric element of the group can operate on a lattice. Such a point group is known as crystallographic point groups. Crystallographic point group can be defined as a group of symmetry elements that can operate on an infinite three-dimensional lattice so as to leave one point unmoved. Rotation axis of order 1, 2, 3, 4 or 6 can operate above on a lattice and thus it itself is a crystallographic point group.
Let us now continue on the point group. Each of the 6 combinations of rotation axis is capable of operating on a lattice. Example 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 3, 2, 2, 4, 226, 233 and 234, and is thus a distinct crystallographic fine group. Each of the inversion axes, 1 bar, 2 bar, 2 bar equals M, operating on its own, thus constitutes a distinct crystallographic fine groups. The operation of a rotation axis of odd order combined with a center of symmetry is equivalent to an inversion axis of the same order. Trivially, 1 plus 1 bar will be simply 1 bar, and more significantly, 3 plus 1 bar will be 3 bar. The operation of a rotation axis of even order, 2, 4 or 6 fold, combined with a center of symmetry is equivalent to the operation of an inversion axis of the same order combined with a center of symmetry. The conventional nomenclature for these three pion groups are 2 over M, 4 over M and 6 over M. Totally, there are 32 crystallographic pion groups, and your molecule, either belonging to small molecule or macromolecule, has to crystallize to only one among the 32 crystallographic pion groups. Space groups. We have just now seen that the crystallographic pion groups are numbering to 32, and they represent the non-translational symmetry elements that can be repeated on a lattice. But when translational symmetry elements like screw axis and glide planes are taken into account, the number of groups of symmetry elements that can be repeated on a lattice increases to 230 and translational of space groups. The thorough explanatory introduction is provided by the International Tables of X-ray Crystallography, Volume 1, published in the year 1969. A space group symbol always consists of two parts. First, a letter to indicate the lattice type. Already we have seen there are four lattice types: P-type, I-type, F-type and C-type. And this first letter denoting the lattice type is followed by a statement of the essential symmetry element present. For example, consider a simple space group P21, which means that lattice is primitive P-type and symmetry element is 2-1 screw axis. Conventionally, the screw is along the y-axis, b-axis. The second part of the space group symbol is of the same form as a point group symbol, but many include reference to translational symmetry elements. Now let us consider the space group C2 over C. This represents a space group of the point group 2 over M, which is one of the point groups of the monoclinic system. The lattice type is monoclinic C. There is a rotation diode parallel to Y and a C-glide perpendicular to Y. Now consider another space group PMCN belonging to the pion group MMM for the orthorhombic system. The lattice type is orthorhombic P. A mirror plane lies perpendicular to X-axis. A C-glide is there perpendicular to Y-axis, and a diagonal glide is there perpendicular to Z-axis. In earlier times, so in the 50s, when visual estimation of intensities was done with Weissenberg camera layer photographs, assignment of space group was a difficult problem because one has to first index all the reflections. So what is the Miller indices for each reflection after taking the layer photographs and know the systematic absences by examining the intensities visually. This is a tedious task. Usually, about 5,000 Bragg intensities will be there. Only the difference is each spot has its own blackness. So, you have to give them numbers for it. Maybe the darkest spot you can give number 100. But how to assign numbers for the other black spots? So, this is a tedious problem in those times. And also, there was no machine to scan this and give the peak profile or how the intensities can be numbered. And this is the drawback. That is why those people used to take years together to determine the molecular structure of even a 20-atom containing structure. Then, one has to infer the detail of symmetry elements present by looking at the absences of certain classes of reflection. because we are going to see later how the presence of certain symmetry elements will affect the occurrence of certain classes of Bragg reflections. For simple example, I'll tell you now, if there is a screw along B axis, then 0 K0 type of reflection, K even alone will be present and K odd will be absent. So theoretically, this is the case, but practically, the K odd reflection among the 0 K0 type will be having a smaller number compared to very larger numbers when 0 K0 K even reflections are there. So now, by looking at these systematic absences, people used to infer what type of symmetry elements is there, then they have to assign their space group. But present day, fast data collection devices take care of this problem automatically.
So students, now let us summarize what we have learned in this module. We have learned that starting from crystals and the definition of unit cell, the concept of lattices was explained. We have seen that there are four types of lattices. One is the primitive lattice, other is the body center lattice, then we have the base center lattice, and we have the face center lattice. And depending upon the type of lattices, the total number of lattice points in the unit cell will be varying. We have also seen what we mean by the Brevi lattices corresponding to the seven crystal systems. Depending upon each system, totally these seven crystal systems lead to 14 types of Brevi lattices. Various types of symmetries are also discussed in this presentation, along with the different lattice directions and the definition of Miller indices. As we have seen already, Miller indices are used to designate a diffracting Bragg plane, and these indices little h, little k, little l can be positive or negative integers including zero. We have also seen the crystallographic point groups and space groups, which are discussed briefly. Totally, there are 32 crystallographic point groups and 230 space groups. Now, as I've been telling repeatedly, when you crystallize, you can have a crystal belonging to a small molecule, or can have a crystal coming from a macromolecule or a macromolecular complexes like protein ligand or protein DNA or DNA drug, whatever is there. Whatever may be the thing, once you have a crystal, whether it is coming from a small molecule or a macromolecule, there are only 7 crystal systems, there are only 14 Brevi lattices, there are only 32 point groups and 230 space groups.